this particular forum. I'm Lieutenant General Terry Wolff, retired, and I'm an ILE senior fellow here with AUSA. And my task today is to really moderate this panel. We are sitting here with a group of experts today, and I will introduce them in more depth in just a moment. But we have with us Dr. Linda Robinson, Dr. Janine Davidson, Dr. Michael Hanlon, and General Dave Perkins. So a little bit about this. Today's panel really is about forcing you to come to grips with and to think about the future of warfare and the role of our Army. And as many of you know, earlier this month, the Army and TRADOC published pamphlet 523, correction, 525-3-1, the Army's Operating Concept, AOC, which is called Win in a Complex World 2020 to 2040. The pamphlet, in my mind, takes stock of the evolving megatrends described in the National Intelligence Community's 2030 global trends and alternate futures. It talks in there about irregular warfare, about hybrid warfare. It talks about the prominent features associated with that sort of threat environment. It talks about intrastate conflict. And it talks about terrorism, subversion, and sabotage, insurgency, criminal activities. It also talks about the differences and distinctions between regular and irregular forms of warfare, which may merge into state-based militias and irregular tactics. This hybrid warfare sort of thing, to me, sounds a lot like what we're seeing with ISIS, to be frank with you. In the foreword, the chief who signed the foreword writes, the AOC concept describes how future Army forces will prevent conflict, shape security environments, and win wars while operating as part of our joint force and working with multiple partners. The AOC guides future force development by identifying first-order capabilities that the Army needs to support U.S. policy objectives. It provides the intellectual foundation and framework for learning and for applying what we learn to future force development under Force 2025 and beyond. The title, Win in a Complex World, emphasizes Ready Land Forces' importance for protecting our nation and securing our vital interest against determined, elusive, and increasingly capable enemies. And while the concept underscores the foundational capabilities the Army needs to prevent wars to shape security environments, it also recognizes that to deter enemies, reassure allies, and influence neutrals, the Army must conduct sophisticated expeditionary maneuver and joint combined arms operations. I'm sure General Perkins will talk a lot more about this when it's his turn to speak, and I think there's a lot there. So our panelists here today, I introduced them by name, but the first who is going to address you is Dr. Linda Robinson, sitting here to my immediate left. Lynn is a senior international policy analyst at the RAND Corporation. Her areas of expertise include national security strategy, international affairs, U.S. foreign policy, security assistance, joint force development, special operations forces, irregular warfare, and stability operation. She just returned from the Far East. She's worked in South Asia, Iraq, the Middle East, and Latin America as a journalist and researcher. And most interesting in my mind, she most recently, with a number of colleagues, published a RAND report entitled Improving Strategic Competence, Lessons After 13 Years of War. So, Linda, please.
Thank you very much for that introduction. And I do have to add, I do not have a PhD, so Linda Robinson is just fine. Thank you so much. I welcome the chance to talk with you today, and I've had strict orders that we are not to exceed 7 minutes. So I would like to first congratulate the Army and TRADOC for the production of the Army Operating Concept. I participated in a few joint concept development efforts, and I know how difficult it is to develop those key ideas and gain the buy-in from a diverse group of stakeholders. And I do think that concepts are a very important part of the process to envision the future and also the force development requirements. And my presentation to you is going to be very brief. I'm going to provide a very quick summary of the 7 lessons that our study derived from an extensive process that included a workshop, an Adelphi poll, and further research and semi-structured interviews. I'm also going to focus on the 7 lessons that we derived that were more squarely aimed at the joint force, and particularly Army and RSOF, as Army was the sponsor of the project. This project, of course, doesn't stand alone. I'm sure most or all of you have read the Decade of War study that the joint staff published a couple of years ago, and I understand there is a volume two in the works as well. And I believe this is incredibly important for us to continue to mine the valuable and unprecedented experiences that the U.S. and its partners have had over these last 13 years. I would submit that the future is not so radically different from this past, and that it's really incumbent upon all of those engaged in these endeavors to try to understand the continuity and learn the lessons. You know, we have this lessons learned phrase that falls so easily from our lips, but it's actually very difficult to learn the lessons, and I think what we found in our study is that the incorporation of these lessons is far from complete. So I'm going to just give you in bullet form the seven lessons. They do overlap in some respects with the Army operating concept, and I'd be happy to discuss those after we finish the presentations. The first lesson that the group found was that making U.S. national security strategy has suffered from a lack of understanding and application of strategic art. The second lesson is that an integrated civil-military process is a necessary but not sufficient condition of effective national security strategy. The third lesson is that because military operations take place in the political environment of the state in which the intervention takes place, military campaigns must be based on a political strategy. The fourth lesson is that because of the inherently human and uncertain nature of war, technology cannot substitute for sociocultural, political, and historical knowledge and understanding. The fifth lesson is that intervention should not be conducted without a plan and preparation to conduct stability operations, capacity building, transition, and if necessary, counterinsurgency. The sixth lesson is that shaping, influence, and unconventional operations may be cost-effective ways of addressing conflict that obviate the need for larger, costlier interventions. And this is actually a very, very important lesson because it suggests that done rightly, these operations would become a main effort of our future endeavors. And the Army operating concept does call this out and specifically refers to creation of a global land network of relationships for early warning, indigenous solutions, and informed campaigns. I would submit that the Islamic State campaign, the activities undertaken by Russia recently, and China are all heavily irregular, even though the terms used in the concept are nonlinear and unrestricted. The seventh lesson is that the joint force requires non-military and multinational partners, as well as structures for coordinated implementation among agencies, allies, and international organizations. So now quickly to the recommendations for the joint force. The first recommendation actually addresses strategic competence, including educating civilian policymakers. But there's a recommendation for revising how policy and strategy are taught in U.S. professional military education to more accurately represent the give and take, the iterative and dynamic nature of formulating policy and strategy, and that military inputs are necessary all along the way. The second recommendation is that the military should examine ways to build effective, tailored organizations that are smaller than brigades and equipped with all the needed enablers to respond to a range of contingencies. And specifically, the Army operating concept calls out the need for integrated, soft, and combined arms teams that are dynamically task-organized. The third recommendation is that special operations forces and conventional forces should expand their ability to operate together seamlessly in an environment of irregular and hybrid threats. And in particular, new operational level command structures could facilitate both soft-centric and soft conventional blended operations. And there are specific statements to this effect in the Army operating concept as well, although I think there's a great deal of work. And having spent a lot of time in Afghanistan in the last few years, I watched a number of evolutions of soft C2 command structures, as well as combinations of conventional forces at the squad level with special operations teams. The fourth recommendation is that innovative and multifunctional personnel can make a smaller force more effective, but the incentives must be systemic to reward personnel for creativity, risk-taking, and acquisition of multiple specialties. The next recommendation is for joint and service capabilities that create and maintain regional familiarity or expertise, advisory capability, and other special skills for regular warfare and stability operations. These must be preserved and refined at the level needed to execute current military plans. This, we'd have a chart in the document that reflects a number of cuts in the budgets that affect those capabilities, which have been built up rather painstakingly over the last 13 years. So it's an explicit call to do more to preserve those critical capabilities that will apply to future conflicts. The last two recommendations are that civilian experts should be co-located at the key commands and in country teams, and when necessary at the tactical level, in formations that provide force protection and enable them to perform their duties. This is kind of a mixed review of all these efforts to get civilians out into the battlefield. As many of you know, it is very difficult for civilians to operate out there. Just having come from the Philippines, there's a lot of drama and trauma around discussions about how civilians are going to remain out in Mindanao doing their development work, doing the outreach work once the OEFP, Operation Enduring Freedom Philippines, ends later this year as planned. Finally, the U.S. government could improve its preparation of U.S. personnel to serve in coalitions and effectively employ non-U.S. expertise by identifying in a systematic manner both its own gaps and the potential external resources to meet them. In a word, what this means is the U.S. can get a lot better at coalition warfare, and we have some specific ideas about how to do that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Linda. So first, a housekeeping note. There are 5x8 cards on your seats, I believe, and those are designed for you to write questions and then pass them to the center at the appropriate time, and we'll kind of weed through those and then bin those to the appropriate panel members. So thanks a lot for doing that. So Dr. Michael Hanlon, many of you know him. He's a senior fellow and co-director at the Center for the 21st Century Security and Intelligence and a director of research for the Foreign Policy Program at the Brookings Institute, where he specializes in U.S. defense strategy, the use of military force, and American foreign policy. He's a visiting lecturer at Princeton University, an adjunct professor at Johns Hopkins University, and a member of the International Institute for Strategic Studies. His most recent book, co-written with James Steinberg, is Strategic Reassurance and Resolve, U.S.-China Relations in the 21st Century. Last week, Dr. O'Hanlon published an article in National Interest, many of you may have seen. It was entitled, America's Big Military Mistake, Cutting Land Forces Too Quickly, in which he made an implicit suggestion that maybe the defense strategic guidance in the QDR and the skimmer resourcing constraints are impacting our ability to deal with the complex world full of enemies and adversaries. He looked at 10 different scenarios in the article, and he talked briefly about those where land power would be needed, and he offered a warning that those who would dramatically scale back American ground power without thinking through such contingencies are moving too fast. Some of you may also have seen the article in Politico either last night or this morning, in which he, with 11 other significant notables in Washington, talked about 12 ways to rethink the defense budget. Michael?
Thank you, General. Thank you, everyone. It's an honor to be here today. And I also want to speak to the Army operating concept, but in an indirect way, by talking about 5 of the 10 scenarios that the General was kind enough to mention that I'm trying to think through in a book project on the future of land warfare. And what strikes me, I'll go through these scenarios and spend about a minute on each one, but what strikes me is that as you look at these different cases, and we can all debate which ones are most plausible and which ones are most demanding, and where the United States should get involved with its own ground forces, even if the circumstances and the contingencies that I'm discussing develop and play out. But what strikes me is the geographic diversity and breadth of the scenario set, which is in accord with the Army operating concept, the importance of not actually having to fight most of these. As you'll see in a second, they're pretty ugly. No surprise to a group like this that's done so much for our country already in a lot of ugly scenarios. But these are scenarios we're trying to deter or otherwise prevent by a combination of our own forward presence, our engagement, helping develop partner capacity. And so I really think that as I work through this list, it should be seen as a broad reaffirmation of many of the main principles that General Odierno and others have come up with in the Army operating concept. So let me just say that by way of introduction. Now, again, in the spirit of brevity, I'm just going to say a couple of words about each of these five scenarios. And the first is a possible Russian threat to the Baltic states, which may seem a little less unthinkable now, unfortunately, than it would have perhaps 12 months ago. Unfortunately, I think it's the sort of scenario we would have to think about responding to directly. More importantly, it's the kind of scenario we don't want Vladimir Putin to even have the least temptation to pursue or to probe us over. We don't want him to think it's possible or plausible. So I'm raising the threshold for this one above the old-fashioned deterrence metric, where you just want to make a would-be aggressor calculate that the costs outweigh the benefits. I want this scenario to be unthinkable to Putin. Unfortunately, I worry that he and maybe even other Russian nationalist leaders would no longer see it as quite so unthinkable if they felt that NATO ground forces were not in a position to respond quickly, because perhaps they could persuade themselves that by slicing off, let's say, some of the eastern sections of these countries, the three Baltic states, or maybe picking one of the three, who knows, but by picking off a eastern slice where there were a lot of Russian speakers, like in Crimea, and where it was relatively difficult for us to deploy forces once Russia was already there, we would be faced with the old-fashioned choice, not of whether you want to trade Washington for Paris or for Tokyo, but do you want to trade Washington for a small farming village in eastern Ukraine, or excuse me, in eastern Estonia? And perhaps Vladimir Putin could persuade himself in his own mind that we would not respond if that were the way we saw the choice, that the nuclear risks would be too much. In other words, if we can't react quickly to make this scenario something that he can't even begin to develop the way he might wish, we should not even therefore be in a position to deter it. This might be the way Putin's mind would work. And I don't want him to have that temptation. So you can get through a lot of detail, just how many deployable forces, how many how many rapidly deployable brigades do we need to have in place. I'm not trying to get to that level of specificity. I'm trying to lay out a scenario that I think is actually non-trivial in its military difficulty, especially for the NATO alliance at this stage in its history, and also non-trivial for its relevance to world events. So that's just scenario one. Scenario two maybe is getting a little further removed from what's been in the headlines lately. It's about Korea, but it's not just the old-fashioned scenario where the U.S. and the ROK might wind up fighting North Korea. I'm worried about the China angle. And as the general mentioned, I was fortunate enough to write a book with Jim Steinberg this past year, our former Deputy Secretary of State, on how to try to improve U.S.-China strategic relations. But I worry about a lot of the dynamics that are at play in the alliance now, as I'm sure do many of you. And one of them I would worry about would be, in the event of a Korea contingency, what role is China likely to play? And I do not believe China would sit it out. I do not believe China would sit it out. I think there is a very low chance that China would want to fight us directly, like back in 1950. But I think there is a high chance that China would want to establish a toehold on the Korean Peninsula in the event of, for the sake of brevity and shorthand, I'll just say either a 50-27 or a 50-29 scenario, either a classic North Korean invasion or a collapse of some form in North Korea. And if for nothing else than to gain leverage for trying to establish the way in which U.S. forces might be postured on a post-conflict reunified peninsula, there's a very high chance in my mind that China would want to establish some facts on the ground and move its own forces into at least northern North Korea. This doesn't mean we should be in a position to want to fight them, but I do think we need to think hard about military coordination, about ways in which we deal at a strategic level with trying to make China part of the solution, not part of the problem. But this has all sorts of ramifications for Korea. And what it suggests to me, frankly, I'll just, on a side note, it's one more reason why OPCON transfer is, to me, a bad idea, because it distracts the alliance from some creative thinking about what we need to do to prepare for the multitude of scenarios that could unfortunately still confront us in that troubled part of the world. So this is not just an old-fashioned armor-on-armor problem, as you know. This is also a regional politics and integration problem, thinking about how to work with Koreans, maybe with Chinese, maybe even others in a complex contingency. Let me try to speed up a little bit here and just mention the last two I'll just mention sort of in bullet form, but I want to spend a minute on India and Pakistan. And I just came from a panel discussion where my colleague Bruce Rydell, who's one of the nicer, smarter, but still scarier guys I know, talked about how he expects a major Indo-Pakistani crisis, or at least thinks it's very likely in the next 12 months. Sees the Pakistanis trying to do a lot to interfere with Prime Minister Modi's initial efforts to improve relations with Pakistan, between Pakistan and India. There have been a lot of, as you know, terrorist attacks or would-be attacks, the recent attempted attack on the Indian consulate in Herat, Afghanistan, which was probably sponsored by some terrorists that Pakistan had cultivated in one way or another historically. The prospect of an Indo-Pakistani war is real, and if that war happens, the prospect of an Indo-Pakistani nuclear war is real. That doesn't have to be our fight, per se, but I would submit to you that if we get to that point where the two countries have started shooting at each other and maybe even started putting nuclear weapons on delivery vehicles and at least starting the nuclear brinkmanship process that is familiar to us from Cold War days and from nuclear theory, but we haven't seen it in the modern world in a while. If we get to that point, and especially if a nuclear weapon or two is used by one side against the other, I think there are all sorts of ways in which the international community and the U.S. military may wind up involved. And without saying or suggesting that we would want to fight our way into the South Asian landmass and take sides in that kind of a nuclear war, what I am suggesting is that the international community might try very hard to essentially impose a peace deal on India and Pakistan, imposing in the sense of a lot of diplomatic and maybe economic coercion, because the prospect of letting these two countries go to all-out nuclear war would be so terrible for the entire planet. And then putting in a peace implementation force to help wrestle with the causes of the conflict in the first place. So, for example, a trusteeship for Kashmir might be one of the things the international community considers, while it also tries to clamp down and demand that Pakistan clamp down on some of the terror groups on its territory. And this could be all part of a package deal. I don't want to get too Tom Clancy on you, but as we think through the various scenarios, this could be part of a package deal by which Pakistan is basically told, listen, there will be a plebiscite someday in Kashmir, if that's really your only concern. But it's not going to be done at the point of a gun. It's not going to be done because you're threatening another attack by Lashkar-e-Taiba or in the context of an all-out Indo-Pakistani war. We're going to settle this down for 10 years. We're going to have an international trusteeship for Kashmir for 10 years. And then there will be a plebiscite once tempers have cooled, governments have changed, and so on. I've already taken plenty of time, so I'm not even going to mention the last two. One was about a Syria peace implementation force, so you probably didn't want to hear that anyway. And the other was about Central America and trying to deal with the problem of organized violence there through something that would look like a stabilization mission. But I think you can see that, at least in my twisted mind, there are enough various scenarios that could occur around the world that would be pretty demanding, that the case for a very diverse ground force in the United States and among its allies is as powerful as ever. Thanks.
Thank you, Michael. Our third panelist is Dr. Janine Davidson. She is a senior fellow for defense policy at the Council of Foreign Relations. Her areas of expertise include defense strategy and policy, military operations, national security, and civil-military relations. Before joining CFR, she was an assistant professor at the School of Public Policy at George Mason University, where she taught courses on national security, civil-military relations, counterinsurgency, and public policy. From 2009 to 12, she served in the Obama administration as a Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for Plans, where she oversaw the development of guidance for military campaign and contingency planning. She also led policy efforts for the U.S. global defense posture, including the military's rebalance to Asia and international agreements related to the U.S. forces stationed overseas. She began her career in the United States Air Force, where she was an aircraft commander and senior pilot for C-130 and the C-17 cargo aircraft. She, about a year ago or so, published an article in the Presidential Studies Quarterly titled Civil-Military Friction, in which she clearly recognized that war is an extension of politics and that we have to conduct military operations to achieve policy goals. But most important, she talked about the frustration, the mutual frustration between our civilian leaders and the military, which begins with cultural factors, which often is embedded into the uniformed military's planning system. Janine.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you so much for having me here. This is an amazing panel, amazing turnout, and an incredibly scary and depressing scenario layout by Mike. so if there's one thing that is certain, I think it is that the future operating environment is going to be complex, it's going to be diverse, and that it isn't like you can just plan for one big kind of warfare and be therefore ready for everything else. And Linda talked about lessons, and I think that is one of the big lessons that that we need to take. And some people are going to look at this concept and they're going to think, wow, the Army wants to do everything. Well, you know what? The Army gets asked to do everything, it turns out, right? And there's a difference between learning and adapting. And adapting is what we've been doing for the last 10 or 15 years, and we did it in the Air Force when I was in the Air Force. Oh, you know, we're not trained for this, but we're going to do it anyway because that's what we do, and then we'll get back to training for what we're supposed to train for. Does that sound familiar to most of you in this room? I did that for, you know, 9 years as a C-130 and a C-17 pilot, and I know that you all have did it in your careers as well. We adapted very, very well in the last 10 years, mainly due to the National Training Centers and the processes put in place, especially in the Army. And I think that you all, Army, should be incredibly proud of that. But now we're at a point where we need to learn, and learning is a little bit different. And learning doesn't mean going back to where you were before. You know, General Odierno mentioned at lunch today that 7 of the 10 division headquarters are deployed around the world right now. What are they doing? They're not doing what you organized, trained, and equipped them for. They're not leading a division in a warfare. They're doing what the nation wants them to do, right? And so as the Army, you can say, well, that stinks, and when we're finished with that, we'll get back to doing what we normally do. But that's not what the Army's doing right now this time, and I applaud you for that. You're saying, look, you know, for 20 years we've been putting square pegs in round holes, and we're stopping and we're pausing and we're saying, it's not just the civilians asking us to do stuff that we're not supposed to do, that we're not designed to do, and there are people out there making that case right now. It's that the world is a complex, yucky place, as Mike just pointed out, and that you're going to get asked to do stuff. And you know, it is actually a good idea for the military to be deployed to Africa right now for Ebola. And I know a lot of people don't believe that, and they don't think that's true. But nobody else can do it, it turns out. That the Army is an incredibly fungible thing, and that it can do a lot of amazing things. And when something like Ebola happens, and when it continues to spin out of control, societies break down. And then we know what to do with the Army. Then we bring him back in. And we don't need to do that. So I think that what's happening right now is that we're all at a very critical sort of inflection point. It's also a very, not just a complex environment, globally, but it is a very political and politicized environment in America right now. Budgets are deeply contested, and people are saying, you know, we fought this war, we don't want to fight any more of these wars, so we'll bring the Army down, and we don't have to do this anymore. Well, you know, policy is something civilians get to do, and it's very different than doctrine. And it's very different than what the Army gets to do. The Army has to organize, train, and equip for what they're most likely going to get asked to do. And it may just be the case, if history is our guide, that it's not what the politicians think that's going to happen. Right? So if you read the strategy, and I was one of the people that helped write the strategy, it has some wishful thinking in there, but that's what policy is. It says, you know what? The last 4 years of war, let's not do that again. Okay, but that doesn't mean, and it actually doesn't say, that we won't be prepared to if we have to. So there's a difference between saying, I as a civilian or the civilians are not going to actively seek out these kinds of wars, and preparing for the type of warfare that you may find yourself in. And that's the difference between learning, and that's also the difference between policy on the one hand and doctrine and strategy on the other. And this is why I applaud the Army for the steps they've been taking in this concept. And there are some things that stand out to me. The first thing that stands out to me is the title, Win in a Complex World. And the first time I saw that, I said, what? Complex I get, but win? You know, what do we really mean by that? We keep asking the Army to do all this other stuff. We don't always ask the Army to go in and vanquish the other military foe and expect political stuff to magically happen after that, which is basically what this concept says. So, hey, you have to read beyond the title. right? It basically says that military force alone is not the way we've been doing it, is not necessarily going to lead to political outcomes. And you have to think through that. And this is something that the Army has to think through, that the military has to think through, that the joint force has to think through. Because when crises happen or when wars start to brew on the horizon, what happens is the civilian leadership turns to you. And they don't just turn on a switch and say, go do what you do. They have a really painful, iterative conversation with your leadership, as General Odierno probably knows. And they want to know, well, what can you do? What is doable? And this is why one of my pet peeves about military doctrine is that there's a lot of lies in military doctrine. There's a lot of myths in military doctrine. There's a lot of things in your JP50 and your Joint Pub 30 and the planning doctrines that basically tells you all that the civilians are for somehow divinely inspired enough to know exactly what end state they want when something bad happens. And they're going to tell you, this is the end state, these are the kinds of resources that we'll let you have, and this is how we want you to do it. Well, it doesn't always work that way, in fact, because they don't do what you do. You spend your entire career thinking about the nature of warfare and how it works. And today, it isn't just even about warfare, it's about conflict. It's about human conflict and the human elements of it. And when the civilians look to the military leadership for answers, they want options. They want more than just, you know, variations on a force concept to get to the same end. They want creativity. And this is also what I see in this concept. We want leaders who can think creatively. We want leaders who understand the human dimensions of war. We want leaders who can explain to and have a conversation with the American society about how to achieve these objectives. So options are incredibly important, and being able to provide those is very important. Another thing I see in the concept is about the Army being able to provide foundational capabilities. That's your toolkit. That provides options for multiple types of contingencies, and that I think is incredibly important. Another element that I think is also very important is the idea of working with partners and allies, and when I say partners, I mean civilian, military, lots of different types of players that bring different kinds of capabilities to these complex environments. And it ties all the way back to strategy. In the strategy, we talk about American leadership in the world, right? And because the vast majority of problems facing the planet today are actually beyond the scope of any one country to fix, and they're beyond the scope of definitely any military alone to fix. So by definition, you have to be operating with other entities and other militaries. And so this is another thing that I think is very important in the concept. American leadership is going to be more than just going out and breaking things and doing things for people. It's about bringing people together and coordinating their actions to solve problems on a multilateral scale. And you see it off the Horn of Africa with piracy, you see it with ISIL, you see it in NATO, you see it all over the Pacific whenever there's a humanitarian crisis. This is what we do, and we do it very well, and we rely on the Army to provide that. And that back to the 7 out of 10 division headquarters, that's the kind of thing that they're doing. And that's incredibly important. That's foundational capability for American leadership in a complex world in the 21st century, and it's incredibly, incredibly important. So I commend you for linking these complex concepts into something that the Army can latch onto and move forward on, and I look forward to helping you get there. Thank you.
Janine, thanks. And our cleanup hitter is General Dave Perkins, our own TRADOC commander. Cleanup kind of like what the Baltimore Orioles need, a cleanup hitter tonight. We'll see where all that goes. So anyhow, General Perkins just took over as the TRADOC commander in March. Previously, as you know, he was out at the Combined Arms Center for nearly 2.5 years. Commanded 4th Infantry Division in Iraq in 2010 and 11. He was commander of the 2nd Brigade, 3rd ID during the famous Thunder Run in 2003. Also served as the Chief of Strategic Effects for MNFI, as well as being the Deputy Chief of Staff for the United States Army in Europe. So, General Perkins, to you, please.
Thanks, Terry. Well, the good thing about being the last person is all I have to say is, yeah, what they said. Are there any questions? And quite honestly, they've actually made my job too easy to kind of wrap this up, and it's almost like we gave them each talking points. But if you know any of them, which you all do, you know they are anything but malleable, and you are not going to prime any of these folks. So it's great to be on the panel with them. One of the things I just would like to do as we get feedback and sort of being a learning organization, lessons learned, is sort of to contextualize the Army operating concept so that every night when you read it before you go to bed, which I'm sure you do, you can sort of understand the greater context and what it is for. And what an Army operating concept does is, in my mind, it really does three things. And I'm just highlighting this because some people think it does everything, or it's going to do their thing, whatever their thing is they want it to do. And I've had people read it, come to me, and words to the effect of, you know, I read through the whole Army operating concept, but it doesn't say anything about, you know, the load plan for my tank, or what's the color of the next stealth bayonet, or something like that. And that's not really what an operating concept does. It will lead to that. We eventually will get to the color of the next stealth bayonet we produce. But what it does is really three things. One, it describes the future operating environment, not predicts it, but describes it. A lot of people want a level of accuracy and prediction that just is not possible. So it describes the future operating environment. Then what it does is describe what capabilities the Army has to have in that environment. And then it talks about how we're going to translate those into capabilities. What capabilities does the Army have to have? And so, and if you take a look at the chapters, they kind of roll out in that way. The first one, sort of describing the operational environment, those of us who have been in the Army for a while have had different operating concepts, and the environments would be described in various ways, sometimes very precisely by a specific enemy, a specific part of the world. And in this case, not, because how I would characterize that is, in a macro sense, you're either looking at a future that is predictable or one that is unpredictable. As I grew up during the Cold War, and Lieutenant Perkins was in Germany and would go to my general defense plan positions, we were training Perkins to deal with a predictable enemy. It's the Soviet Union. It's going to be on the central plains of Europe. It's a known coalition, NATO. It has known STANAGs. It has known TTPs, et cetera, like that. And then Perkins, you get a battle book, and every quarter you go up there and mark where your tanks are, and you measure how long it takes to drive, and if anything new happens, you put it on the battle book. Hey, new high tension wires are going to take it down. Because what we wanted Lieutenant Perkins to do was compliance with the plan of a known enemy in a known part of the world with a known coalition. As we describe the future environment here, and you've heard it a lot of the scenarios and various things, this Army operating concept was written specifically to deal with the unknown. What we're saying is, hey, Lieutenant Perkins, we don't know what we're going to do with you. In fact, I know on good accord there actually is a Lieutenant Perkins out there right now, and that's kind of what we're telling him. We don't know. You may have to go to Africa. You may have to go to the Baltics. You may have to go to Korea. I don't know, and I don't know who your coalition partners are. And I don't know what the grand policy is going to be. But I do know that I want you to go there, and I want you to exceed all expectations and accomplish the mission given to you. That's actually very clarifying to really just that digital thing. Are you dealing with a known environment or unknown? Because once you make that decision, you build a different kind of army. You build a different kind of army. You train and develop different kinds of leaders. And so it actually adds great clarity to that. Then the next thing it does, after you sort of define the operating environment, you talk about the capabilities that the Army needs to operate in that. And some people will read this and they come back to me, and it's been mentioned here, like, well, you know, gosh, you guys are like all over the map. You're talking about, you know, peer competitors, and then you're talking over here about counterinsurgency kind of things. You're talking about megacity. You're talking about this. Do you have a lack of decision-making capability? I mean, just kind of pick one thing and go with it. The problem is the United States Army is not a boutique force, okay? We are not a niche capability. The United States Army has great niche capabilities. We enable niche capabilities, but we are not a boutique force. We really, you know, people say, hey, choose a core competency and kind of go with that. Focus on that. You can turn it into a bumper sticker. It'll be easy to get funding for. You can build a constituency, find out what congressional districts that boutique capability is made in, and you'll have it done. Life will be easy. Well, the problem with that is the Army really sort of has two major competencies. One is to ensure the survival of our nation, okay? And the second one is that we are the foundational force of the joint force, and we enable and help deploy all elements of national power. So if you want to say the Army has a competency, those are really sort of the two competencies. But that actually is very clarifying as well when you understand that. Because then you say, well, okay, how do I go about doing that? Because now I have to have capability for an unknown world, and I have to do many things. So I have to, as was mentioned before, I don't only have to adapt, I have to innovate. And then we say, well, there are different ways to innovate. When you have a known world, the way you generally innovate is creating great differential between your capability and your enemy's capability. So if you know your enemy is driving T-55 tanks, you just differentiate through innovation a large amount, and you build an M1 tank that is many echelons greater than that, and it will be a long time before that gap is closed. But if, on the other hand, you have no idea who your enemy is, you can't only put all your stock in innovation of differentiation. You have to put it in speed of innovation. So speed of innovation of your materiel, speed and innovation of your leaders, okay? Because we can't tell Lieutenant Perkins where he's going. What we're saying is you're going to go someplace. Is going to be unknown, and things are going to happen, and they're going to happen very quickly because the world is complex, which means unknown, unknowable, and constantly changing. So we have to enable that young leader, both through training, education, organization, and materiel, to have the ability to innovate very quickly. And that goes everything from sort of the materiel aspect of it, when we buy stuff for the Army, to, again, how we organize ourselves, and how we then apply all the elements of national power. And so one of the questions people ask me about this operating concept, they always want sort of the before and after. Well, what's different between previous ones? Well, a couple of them I outlined already. One, this is specifically to deal with the unknown. The second thing in, when in a complex world, that first word has a lot of meaning, when, but the first part of it I would put out that when is a strategic issue. You don't win at the tactical and operational level. You facilitate a win, but you win at the strategic level, which means, as was just mentioned, that means Army leaders have to think that way, and that's why they have to be able to be engaged in ability to employ all elements of national power along with coalition, partners, NGOs, all of that, because that's generally how you win. And then you have to constantly innovate because that definition of win may change. So there's a lot of meaning in that first word, win, but we're saying that is a significant difference because we're saying in the world that we're going into, that is one of the niche capabilities of the Army, is that we allow our nation to win, and that's just the intellectual process as far as, and as well as bringing the whole team together. And then the complex part of it is defined as a future that's unknown, unknowable, and constantly changing. And so there are some significant, more than just nuanced differences in this Army operating concept than previous ones before that, because it is going to drive everything we do. DOTMIL PF, again, the doctrine, organization, training, leader development, all of those kind of things. But we are doing it in a way that this is not Army-centric. If you read through the Army operating concept, we have focused a great amount of time and effort into what does it do for the joint force. How does it interoperate with the rest of our coalition partners? Because then that also is very clarifying, saying, well, if you are going to be the foundation for the joint force, if you are going to be the sort of the foundational capability to employ all elements of national power, and part of an element of our national power is our coalition, what kind of mission command and control systems do you buy? Does it allow others to interoperate? When folks come in the back door of your tactical operations center, if it's Doctors Without Borders or UNHCR or a NATO partner, can they plug in automatically? Do you have a decision-making process that takes them into account that allows you to apply all those elements of power? So this is actually a fairly comprehensive view of this. And then the last chapter tells you how we are going to take these concepts, which are concepts, and then transition them into actual capabilities to our warfighting challenges, because in the end, you have to make a decision, you know, what is the next bayonet I'm going to buy? What does a division look like? How do I train a major at Command General Staff College? But those have to be answered within the context of the big questions of, is that going to allow me to win? Is that going to enable me to operate in an unknown environment? Is that going to allow me to innovate faster than somebody else because I can't just count on the differentiation of it? So having clarity in what the purpose of the operating concept is, as well as some of the distinct differences, I think is a key point that people understand or need to understand before they spend much more time with it. And with that, Terry, I'll turn it back to you.
So thanks. What I'd like to do is kind of bend the first two questions that I had that I've received in kind of this manner. General Perkins has kind of talked about the purposes of the AUC and the overarching concept. I kind of described that in my own mind as, you know, ends in the way and kind of the end state in the way that he has laid out a journey that we're going to take with this. One of the questions came in, talked about, are there changes in the institutional processes that have to occur to bring this thing to life? And so if I can kind of ask General Perkins to take that first, and then we'll come down this direction with that.
Yeah, Terry.
Because it gets at end states in my mind, ways and means. So that's about the ways. And then there's a means component, which Michael talked about in his most recent op-ed, which gets at, you know, you're asking the Army to do a lot, and we're struggling with sequestration challenges and things of that sort. That gets at the means component of it all.
Yeah, so the institutional part of it, this is not a minor portion of this, I'll tell you. And so as General Sullivan, I'm always reminded, always says, the intellectual leads the physical. And what the AOC is, it's really the beginning of our intellectual process. And we have a sort of a big five in here, kind of like the big five we grew up in early in battle. But one of them is adaptable professionals and institutions. And so if we want to innovate faster than somebody else, we want to increase the rate of innovation, a lot of that occurs in the institution. And I'll start with my own institution, TRADOC. I always remind my staff, when people say, well, that's a Tradocean-like bureaucracy, it is not a term of endearment. How good can TRADOC, if we're going to send, for instance, somebody to Africa, you know, if they didn't have an Ebola rotation at the NTC, I mean, how do you get them up to speed so that when the 101st Airborne Division goes over there with great infantrymen, do they know something about pandemic kind of challenges and how you work with that? So since the world is unknown, how are we going to quickly provide context and understanding to people that are constantly going into new situations? So we're taking an extensive look at that. We actually have dramatically, when in doubt, reorganized. So we reorganized TRADOC. But we have really aligned it such that certain pieces of TRADOC can sort of have the rose pinned on them to do that. And we think the human dimension, as was mentioned here earlier, which is a major component of this, is one of our keys to innovate. And so we put a lot of that capability, all our centers of excellence under Combined Arms Center, Lieutenant General Bob Brown out there, to focus specifically on that so we can innovate it. But then it's also, how does the institution interoperate within itself? So we spent a lot of time in TRADOC with our good friends on the Army staff, with the chief and the secretary, saying, you know, we need a different governance process. How do we make decisions at a senior level to quickly drive change? How do we affect resourcing differently? How do we interface with OSD? This morning I was up on Capitol Hill talking to members up there, kind of talked about this winning in a complex world, innovating quicker. They said, you know what? We probably need to change our acquisition process, because it may not be the most innovative way to do things. It may not be the most adaptable. So this is fertile ground, because if you can't get the institution to do it, it's going to be very difficult for soldiers to do it on their own. And I'll pass it off, I don't know, Michael or someone else.
General, I'll just add one quick word, which is on a big topic. I don't think I have the expertise with a lot of the detailed structures in the Army that many people in this room obviously do, to comment in any kind of great detail about rearranging a lot of the internal wiring diagrams. But I think a broad argument I would make is, as the Army looks to the future and thinks about the mix of the active force and the reserve component, especially if and when we get to that day, which will be very fortunate for the nation, but very tough intellectually for the Army, when the Korea conflict is somehow resolved, and that's no longer the obvious bogeyman to which one can point to justify force structure, one has to think how much of a shift in the AC-RC mix is healthy and consistent with your concerns about institutional development. And my instincts, and I'm not as far along in this thought process as I need to get for my book project, but my instinct is that the balance today looks pretty good to me, and I would get nervous about a major shift towards the old-fashioned sort of citizen-soldier construct with a much greater dependence on the National Guard, because I think many of the capabilities that allow for the adaptability of the Army require, frankly, full-time development. And it's not to say that people in the National Guard aren't a very important part of it, but I think when we're talking about developing regional political expertise, staying in the mix, staying in contact with leadership abroad, staying in contact with different parts of the U.S. government, not just the other services, but other agencies as well outside of DOD, I feel like this requires the day-to-day familiarity that comes from a full-time profession. Now, it doesn't mean, you know, there may be certain professions in the civilian world that are consistent with this kind of preparedness, too, where one could be a full-time professor or businessman or this or that, and then be a guardsman on the side and be developing the right mix of skills so that if and when the nation needed your full-time service, you could do it. But I think it's harder to do that in the National Guard. So the main thing I would say, it's a very broad-level comment, General, but it's the most important thing I believe I can offer to this question, is to say shifting the mix of AC and RC dramatically is probably an idea we should be very wary about. Even if we get to the happy day when there are fewer acute, obvious next threats that might make some people want to cut back the active force a great deal.
Mike, thank you.
Yes, I think that there are quite a few institutional changes that are incumbent. If the the chief's letter prefacing the Army operating concept called for the joint operations to contribute to sustainable political outcomes, which kind of meshes with our emphasis on the importance of having a political strategy. There was a seventh warfighting function that was promulgated last year, engagement. I don't know how many people have delved into that. I think this opens up an entire new area for PME and a very serious expansion of the military competence in this regard. I think in the future, and I did see and hear this at the Unified Quest game, some exploration of changing perhaps in the future the BCT-based organization, which would be profound and it will take a while, but worthy of exploration. I think soft conventional force interdependence also implies institutional and perhaps organizational change. And finally, I think the personnel, if we're looking at a smaller force, I think that you have to look at personnel changes so you guarantee that you have that highly skilled and very multi-skilled personnel.
I'll just add a little bit on that. I agree with what they're saying, but I think also when you look back at what I was talking about before about learning versus adaptation, if you take a pause and think back about how painful certain things have been over the last 10 to 20 years, and then ask yourself honestly, is it because the environment wasn't bending to me, the Army, or because the Army isn't bending to the environment? So if you're constantly being asked to deploy in smaller units, you need to think about what that means for how you're organized and structured. On the other hand, you also have to be the ones that are ready for the other kind of warfare. So how do you do that? How do you break into smaller units to do the kinds of things Linda's talking about, and to be engaged, but then also kind of rally back in when you have to do something larger? And I think that I don't have the answer, but I think there are institutional things that need to be explored on that for that. And then the other thing I'll say is the emphasis of operating as well as fighting with partners of all kinds. And I'd like to see that integrated into training as a requirement. So what I mean by that is, I remember being in visiting forces in Europe and thinking, you know, for many years, and I think it's kind of changed a bit, but for many years, you know, you're focused over there when you're Lieutenant Perkins on the Fold a Gap, training yourself, being ready for the big one. But if that's what you need to do, and you guys can train at home, right? We don't need to posture you forward. We posture you forward from a strategic and geopolitical and political reason in order to engage with allies and partners. So is it part of your mettle structure that you have to be required to have a certain level of competency in operating with coalition partners? And this is something that I think the regional alignment may need to hit, but it needs to be integrated down into all those institutional systems, the things that motivate leaders to do what they need to do.
Can I ask as a follow-up then, are there things that, and General Perkins, you touched on this, but are there leader development things that have to be done in terms of, you know, bringing the visualization, the intellectual curiosity, and those things to bear? Because I've got several questions from our audience have asked about that. You know, how do you now get your leader development programs so that they're allowing you to either drive change, or the leader development programs are pulling the institutional army and the operating force along so it's capable of beginning to come to grips with all this?
Yeah, Terry, I mean, actually, we spent a lot of time on this. You know, the aspect of critical thinking, it's inadequate to say, well, it ought to be an elective at the War College. And that's when we starting critical thinking. In fact, we actually start it when they get off the bus at basic training. We have changed the aspect of basic training, so they have to start applying critical thinking skills between the bus and the drill sergeant. So it's a little bit before the War College elective. But Terry, I think it really does drive it. I mean, historically, change in our Army, a lot of it has been driven through PME, and then the graduates go out to the operating force and propagate that change out there. And so that's one reason why we have realigned a lot of our capability in TRADOC that way. And as the chief said at lunchtime, we're in the process of putting together Army University, where we bring all our elements of PME together under sort of one governance structure so that we can take a look from, you know, beginning of basic training to War College or whatever and say, how are we taking a threat, let's say critical thinking, and how does that push through all echelons of PME? But it's insufficient just to say that, because a lot of times leader development we associate to the brick and mortar schoolhouse, the institutional part of it. There's the operational part of it, but then there's also the self-development part. In the Army, we think the part that we have least leveraged well is self-development. And both through technology as well as leadership focus, we think, especially when you're looking at critical thinking and ability to innovate, that a lot more can be done in that area. So we're putting a lot of effort on that, because we think that can drive it, not only sort of follow it.
Can I ask, I mean, Linda, you've written a little bit about this, because you talked to some degree about this in your lessons learned in terms of, you know, critical thinking and the way to relook what 13 years have trained us to do. Is there anything from a leader development perspective that you would, you know, that you would just kind of throw out on the table off the top of your head? I'm putting you on the spot. I get to do that.
Yes, well, it's not in the report, but I will say, as a member of the Board of Visitors for both NDU and chair of the Army War College Board, the first thing that has to happen is no more cuts to those budgets, because I believe that is absolutely vital to strategic leadership, and it's the seed corn of the future, and frankly, it's budget dust.
I understand. Janine, how about you? Because you talked a little bit about building partner capacity and, you know, thinking about dealing with allies and partners. But is it an extension into the interagency discussion that, you know, you and I have had previously?
Yeah, I mean, I think that exposing young leaders to an interagency environment is very important. But I do think that there's a limit to that, right? Because if I am a State Department person and I want to engage with my Army person, or if I'm at a combatant command and I want to engage with State, I don't want to engage with like the State person that's on my staff. I want the Rolodex for the people that are back at those departments. So I think there's a lot of enthusiasm for seconding everybody from, you know, the Army over into the State Department and whatnot. And I think we need to do some of that, but you need to be still grounded in your own institution. It needs to be about integration. I think also that when you're thinking about critical thinking, I mean, some of the most brilliant military leadership has sort of a level of blink knowledge, right? Like they sort of intuitively know what to do. Well, you know, when you peel the onion back a little bit, those generals have been studying history, political affairs, international relations. You know, the eat your vegetables kind of courses in political science. And as a professor of political science, it's really important to have context for the environments in which you're operating. So it isn't just about training, it's also about education. And I think pulling those two things together in complex ways in exercises is really important. But you've got to have that raw material, those vegetables that, you know, in order to be able to make sense of that environment, to then make the decisions.
Fair enough. So, General Perkins, one of the interesting questions that someone I threw up here on one of the five five-by-ed cards is this. It has to do with how well this AOC is integrated into where the other services are going and into joint doctrine. So just if you would address that, please.
Yeah, you know, that was very important to us, and the chief gave us very clear guidance on that. So actually, before I even started reading drafts that HR and his folks would send me, I went down to Quantico and spent time with Mick Siddick and Ken Glock, a former boss of mine actually in Iraq, and actually read their operating concept, Expeditionary Force 21, actually talked to the authors, read all the others, read the Navy's and the Air Force's, read it through. In fact, I probably know maybe more about their operating concept than maybe a lot of their folks, just like probably a lot of people in the Army haven't read ours yet. But, and so we were very careful to say, you know, this is not going to be a mini QDR. This AOC, in other words, kind of roles and responsibility, like, yeah, they said they do that, but we do it better, you know, or they can do this once and we can do it 20 times. What we try to be is take a look, say, okay, this is what the Navy's talking about, this is what the Air Force is talking about, this is what the Marine Corps is talking about. Well, we really could leverage that capability. In fact, this is one of our roles, because one of the things we highlight is that we are the foundational force for the joint force in many ways. That what does the Army have to do to enable the Marine Corps to do what it does, provide logistics? What does the Army do for the Navy? It sets the theater in the Pacific. And so how can we do a better job at that? And so have actually spent a considerable amount of time with our counterparts trying to understand how they view their role, and then where can we leverage where possible, or how does the Army enable it? So hopefully that comes out in the document, that we have tried to look at this from a really specifically a joint perspective.
Anyone else like to add to that? Okay. General Perkins, can I ask one other follow-up then on that same line of thought? Is so understanding the AOC, then where, you know, what trickles down underneath it is, you know, as you as the owner of TRADOC lay out the doctrinal support and the doctrinal, you know, manuals and publications that then nest underneath this.
Yes, well, I have the Army operating concept, and that generates the other warfighting concepts. With our warfighting functions, and as you said, we now have a seventh one engagement. So we have the various proponents of that, of our centers of excellence. They now take the Army operating concept, say, okay, what's my bit and piece of this? How do we take a look at it? And then our kick under HR's leadership are having these warfighting challenges. Now, the thing that I would want to make folks understand, this is not like a one-year project. This is not like the year of the AOC. And we're going to do it and then be done, et cetera, that the Army has to be a constantly, as you said, learning, adapting, innovating organization. And so we've had to kind of put together this construct, but we think we don't want the Army to innovate in fits and starts according to whatever the OCO funding is or POM or something, that the Army as an institution has to constantly have a way to learn and innovate. And so we're building that capacity in the Army to do it constantly. How do we constantly bring in lessons learned? How do we constantly work with our joint partners, with our coalition partners? And how do we constantly innovate and adapt and be a constantly improving organization? And so we have this year, we have 20 warfighting challenges. We have five a quarter, very specific problems we're looking at. But that's going to occur a quarter after quarter after quarter. We'll learn something from that. We'll go back and look at our warfighting specific doctrines on that, and then we'll update it, and then we'll work, you know, whether the acquisition community or say, you know, there's a training and leader development part of that. We're not covering that at Command General Staff College. What can we do? We got to change the POI. Is there a material aspect to it? I'm not saying this is an answer. Should we not be a BCT? Is that not the right coin in the realm organization? So we constantly are moving these things, and it really becomes more of a mindset than a science project. It's just how the Army tries to stay ahead of the power curve here.
So I'm going to shift gears a little. We've had a couple of questions up here kind of about the means, and it's all tied around the sequestration elephant in the room. And the chief this morning, the secretary both talked a little bit about that. I'd like to turn to Michael first to talk a little bit about, you know, kind of how can you innovate and do all this with the five scenarios you laid out, the budget cuts that are looming if sequestration kicks back in 16. And so how do we still find out and, you know, create these group of young leaders and senior leaders that are able to, you know, move forward and try to bring this thing to life?
Yeah, General, thank you. I'm going to probably give an answer that has a little more to do with politics than with Army internal organization. So but it's the best answer I can come up with to your question, because I guess the short answer, just to focus narrowly on the question as posed, is it's going to be very hard if we really see sequestration again. And what sequestration means, as you all know, is a budget gets passed that exceeds the caps. And then come January 1st next year, 2016, in the absence of a compromise, then you have an automatic set of reductions across the board. And as we all know, and General Odierno and many of you better than any of us in the civilian world, it just makes the rest of the world, the rest of the year becomes a fire drill. And luckily, the people who are at the war colleges can probably stay there, and you still have a lot of good things happen within the Army, but it's a ridiculous kind of world to live in. And so I hope we don't have to, as a nation, put the armed forces through that again. But I think a couple of things. First of all, in broad terms, there is some good news, or there is at least some reason to hope this won't get too bad. One is that I haven't given up hope yet there'll be another deal like the Ryan Murray deal that will make the budget cuts softer for 16 and 17. I don't know what it would be. This would probably have to sort of be an immaculate conception at some point in the next few months. I don't even know what's being discussed right now, but I haven't given up hope that in a world like today's, with all the turbulence around the planet and a demand on the part of the public for at least a certain form of American leadership, even if people are still war-weary and not anxious to send you back to a conflict like Iraq or Afghanistan again, there's still a sense among the American public that we need to be strong. Everyone would love to relive the Reagan years, right? You build up the military, keep it shiny, and don't use it very much. That's always the preference. And maybe that's sort of where the political debate goes. But can't we try to reassert our strength and reassert and reaffirm deterrence and hopefully have some good things happen around the world as a result? We can all debate how much that would benefit the international security environment, but I do think the political debate is going to be moving in that direction, which then leads to my final thought on this issue, which is that even if sequestration does happen in 2016, or if somewhat different variant on the same thing, the Congress appropriates money and funds for the Pentagon that are at the sequestration level caps, so you get that kind of a budget cut, but no sequestration per se. In other words, you don't have the automatic cuts across the board. You just comply with the anticipated sequestration ceilings in advance and thereby avoid the need. Anyway, even if you had one of those two scenarios in 2016, I don't think it's going to continue past the 2016 presidential election. I think both parties are going to nominate internationalists. Even if it's Rand Paul, his only choice to become the nominee of the Republican Party is to sound like Ronald Reagan or to say, what I want to do is build up the military and then not have to use it. And you already see him in his own rhetoric inching a little more in that direction than you did a year or two ago, I would submit. And so certainly in the two major political parties, given what we're seeing around the world today, and I realize this is not a position we can widely debate, certainly by my friends in uniform at this kind of a juncture, but I would suggest that we have to get through the next couple of years, and then the chances are things will get a little bit better. Not a lot better. Not big $50 and $100 billion a year buildups, but no more worry about sequestration, some kind of mechanism to replace the Budget Control Act of 2011, and at least a modest upward trajectory in the defense budget. The bad news is, even if I'm right, it may take 2 years to get there.
Janine?
I'm a little bit, I'm cautiously optimistic that things, I do believe that the general outline of what you just said is true. The American people are looking at the world. We've got from Ebola to ISIS to NATO and Putin to the rebalance to Asia and everything else, the American people are starting to question, you know, what the heck is going on and what needs to be done abroad. And I think that they are, I think we're going to potentially get a wake-up call with the elections in November. You know, so you could get a little bit of a, you know, people aren't going to do anything between now and then. But what kind of sort of emotional change is likely to happen in rhetoric and everything else where you have certain people that are up for re-election are going to be able to come off of those hard stance? That's the only thing that makes me moderately more optimistic than Mike, but still I do think that it's going to be a long road. In the meantime, what can the services do, right? If you are held to sequestration and you can't move things around and adjust the way you need to, it's going to be really hard. But I think that Linda is spot on, that if there's one thing you have to fight to protect, it's got to be education and training, and it's got to be investing in leadership. Because when the faucet turns back on and you have a hollow force without leaders who know what to do with that money and how to regenerate, then you're going to be in trouble. So, you know, just as in the inner warriors where you're sort of you're incubating new ideas and you're thinking through things, it's got to happen. The intellectual investment has got to be protected and sustained, and it will be it's budget dust, as Linda says, but it becomes the most important thing when the pendulum swings.
Linda, anything you'd like to add?
Well, I just think it is an interesting moment that perhaps the budget changes, as has been said, will come about through recognition that indeed the world is a messy place. The Army, as the largest force, has to be supported for this range of tasks it's already being called upon to do. And we've been through this period, I think, of wanting, yearning for a cheap and easy and simple way to address messy problems, and there is no silver bullet. And we've kind of gone, I think, as I look back at these 13 years, from perhaps maximalist or overly aspirational approaches to perhaps overly minimalist approaches, and maybe we'll be able to come back in the middle now and find, with adequate funds, the right path forward. So we'll see if the political winds blow in that direction, but it certainly is the way I'm looking at the world, is you have got to have budget relief to pursue U.S. interests in the world.
So if I follow up on that question from hearing the three of you, is the question is, the staffers this morning heard the chief and the secretary describe their concerns. General Perkins, you were just up on the hill talking about this concept. The question is, they're being talked to, are they listening, and is the message getting through? And is there anything else in your mind that we can do as you talk about the future, you know, but you certainly bridge from the current?
Yeah, I think it has been mentioned here already that there is sort of a realization of the sort of the unpredictability of the world and the dangerous part of it is. The other part with regards to the role of the AOC, you know, in era of sequestration, whatever, we specifically wrote the AOC, it doesn't talk about force structure, budget or something, did not want to be constrained by that. But actually, in periods of resource constraint, in some ways, it's even more important. Because if you have all the money in the world that you need, and it's just the biggest challenge is you don't have enough time to spend all the money you have, in some ways priorities aren't as important, or a vision is not important, because you can just spend money on anything. When priorities are very important and the vision is very important is when you have limited resources and you have to make decisions, do I do this or not do that? So if you say we're going to have a resource-constrained environment, the first thing I would say is we better come up with some priorities. We better come up with a vision. We better figure out what the Army is for. And so I would say the more resource constrained, the more important a good operating concept is. Chief.
I got it. This is a really important question. I'm going to talk to the guys people in uniform right now. So everybody's heard my feelings on sequestration, but I'm not going to talk about that. The Army operating concept is based on what we believe the future environment we're going to have to operate in. The budget doesn't impact that. So it is important for us to grab this concept and develop capabilities to operate in this future environment, no matter how much money we have. And that's the important part of this. The budget has to do with capacity. And it has to do with, my biggest fear is we're going to be asked to do more with less. And that's when we get ourselves in trouble. But that doesn't have anything to do with the operating concept. The operating concept is for us to understand the environment we're going to have to operate in. And then how do we adjust and change ourselves to operate in that? And it's regardless of how much money we have. And in fact, as General Perkins just said, it becomes more important with the less money we have. Because we have to adjust and change so we become more capable of operating in this new complex environment that we're going to operate in. And I think that's the important part. If we let budget get in the way of us looking at this operating concept, we're going to be in trouble. Regardless, as I said before, I've been very vocal on my thoughts on the budget. But I also believe we have to do this regardless of the outcome of the budget fights. And it's up to us in uniform to make sure we carry this on and work at it and make sure that it is a real priority for us to adjust ourselves to make ourselves as efficient and effective as possible in understanding the new environment. I couldn't agree more with the comment made about the one thing we can't ever back off on is leader development and our ability to continue to adjust and adapt, because that's, if you look at the interwar years, that's what we did. We had leaders, although our army got very small, our leaders continued to learn and adapt and try to improve themselves so when the time came, they were prepared. So regardless of budget, we have to work this. And that's why the document is so important right now, is because it's in a time of budget pressures. And frankly, if the budget pressures go away next year or the year before, they'll be back in 10 years or 5 years or 6 years, because they will come back again. And so we have to have a concept that allows us to overcome that as we go forward. So that's why, I'm sorry to interrupt, but I think it's a really, I thought it was a really good question. And I think it's an important one for us to understand who's wearing this uniform as we take this forward. Sorry, thanks.
Sure, thanks. So, General Perkins, one kind of follow-up question for you, if you wouldn't mind. Would you, and then there's a couple of current ops questions we'll go into to give you Michael a warning, because they want to know more about Russia and other locales. So, but just a question for you, as you all put together this concept, it's evolutionary in nature, not revolutionary.
Right.
I mean, you based it, what was your framework from where you started as you put this concept together?
Well, part of the problems when people, and it's kind of like one of the comments before, sometimes you read these documents, whether they're doctrine or strategies or something, and they really are a little fanciful. I mean, they are very wishful thinking, and we use terms that sound good and we would like it to be true. Dominate this and quick wars and stuff. In fact, some of the documents you read, it kind of sort of reminds me of, I go TDY a lot, and you get the hotel room at midnight, and you're going through the TV channels, you get a infomercial on some new diet pill that, just take this pill, you don't have to exercise, you can eat all the donuts you want, and you still lose weight. It's an easy plan. And so, of course, versus you go to the next channel, and they're like, hey, the only way to lose weight is you're going to have to exercise every day, you have to eat your vegetables on that. It's like, hey, I'll take the pill and donut plan here. And so, quite honestly, we've tried to write this that, this Army operating concept, this is the eat the vegetable and exercise plan. Okay, this is not the take the pill and eat the donut plan. That the way you build an army, you have to be realistic and you have to take into account the continuities of war, as HR is always reminding me. That, and again, we mentioned it here, war is an extension of politics. And if you want to win at the strategic level, you have to come up with sustainable goals. And sustainable goals means it takes a while to get after this. So that means you have to have a wide breadth of capability. So we've tried not to fall into the trap of wishing away the hard part of war, the continuities of war. But we want to make sure that we can innovate to stay up with the characteristics of war. So as new technology comes up, as new dynamics occur, and in the way that humans either operate in cyber or something like that, that we can innovate and stay in front of that, but that we're not wishing a war the very hard, difficult parts of the continuities of war. So we've tried to balance it, and we've tried not to fall into the trap of the easy war. It breathes well. It's a good bumper sticker. The PowerPoint slides are already made. And so if you read through this concept, you're like, wow, the Army's biting off a lot here. I don't think this is going to be easy. And so we've tried to be realistic. As I said, one of the niche capabilities of the United States Army is to ensure the survival of the United States. And that's not a pill and donut plan.
Thank you. So the current ops question, this goes to Michael. And Michael, it's right down your bailiwick. And so here's the question. Would you agree that Putin's Russia and the Chinese Communist Party, we'll call it China, have visions of a global order different from the current one?
My best.
And does that mean that we're destined for conflict?
My best interpretation of Putin, and I'm indebted to my colleagues who are writing a book on Putin, and I've been reviewing what they're doing, and of course I'm sure like all of you fascinated by watching it and trying to read a lot of different source material. I don't think Putin has an image of world domination like the Soviet Union once did, but he does have a revanchist image of restoring greatness to Russia as the sort of central Eurasian power. And I think he sees Russia in its rightful, proper place as one of the world's probably three superpowers, and you can guess what the other two would be. And I think that, you know, occasionally you hear discussion of protecting Russian speakers and ethnic Russians wherever they may be, which does unfortunately include parts of the Baltic states, not to mention other parts of the former Soviet Union. And I think that's an agenda that Putin has in part of his brain. He also feels like we were obnoxious and triumphalist and arrogant in how we dealt with the aftermath of the Cold War, and that we broke our promises to Russia about not expanding NATO and not taking advantage. And I'm not suggesting Putin's correct in all of this, but obviously. But I do believe that's how he feels. And whether it is a genuinely intellectually derived conclusion or it sort of comes out of his personality, which I think is in many ways a petty and an arrogant one, and I don't mean to associate those concepts with the 85% of all Russians today who support him. I think they're frustrated more than they are angry, arrogant, and petty. But I do think Putin is those things. And so, but he's also not dumb enough to want to get into a war against the United States. So what he's going to try to do, I believe, and he'll probably try to do it as long as he's in the Kremlin, is to look for opportunities to push back against NATO's successful expansion and to find ways to capture or cover more of the greater Russian nation within either his direct control or at least keep it out of the NATO orbit. So, for example, we could really force another crisis if we get serious about proposing NATO membership for Ukraine. And by the way, I'm not in favor of it. So I'm not suggesting we should appease Putin, but I also think we have to sort of figure out the best mechanisms to push back against him. But this is my best understanding of what he's up to, which means, frankly, I'm taking the quote-unquote Russia threat a lot more seriously than I did 2 or 3 years ago, because I don't think it's necessarily over. I don't think he wants war, but I think he could do some things that raise the risk of war. And one of the things we have to be able to do to push back is to have a strong deterrent capacity, not only in terms of the size of our standing military, but in terms of our national declaratory policy on how we would handle any threats to NATO powers, and perhaps on some of our forward basing and forward deployments, where I do think we have to have an ongoing conversation about whether we've done enough so far with this 4,000-person rapid reaction force for the Eastern European members of NATO in that area. So that would be my read on Russia. You probably heard enough from me already that I probably shouldn't launch into a similar diagnosis of the Chinese political and strategic mind. But I'll just say one thing on that front, which is I'm very worried about China. That's why Jim Steinberg and I wrote the book. But I'm also partially relieved that most of the big nasty, unpleasant things China seems to be wanting to do right now are in the maritime domain. Not because that keeps the U.S. Army out of the picture, because as you heard me say earlier, it may not keep you out of the picture in Korea, and that could have China implications. But I think China's looking for opportunities to push and expand its influence where international law and traditional borders don't necessarily give an answer as to what the final arrangement should be. In other words, it's trying to be opportunistic. It's not trying to do old-fashioned interstate conquest, and I don't believe it will. But I think wherever there's ambiguity or grayness in the situation, especially in the maritime domains of the Western Pacific, China will look to assert itself for a number of reasons, including historical animosity against Japan, a little bit of historical animosity against us, a desire to sort of sow its own oats and feel its own new capabilities as a rising superpower, and to try to translate that into some benefits for the nation. So the good news, if I'm right, is that it's largely about the maritime regions of the Western Pacific. The bad news is that it won't stop anytime soon, and we're going to have to learn to live with it and find ways to push back against it for a long time to come.
So, you know, maybe 8 years ago, if I were in Moscow and I was doing the same job that General Perkins was doing, I might have put together my Russian AOC concept. And my Russian AOC concept had this version of hybrid war, which has, you know, been, you know, perfected through operations in Georgia and then in the Crimea and certainly now in the Ukraine. So they've come up with a bit of a different model too. So I know Linda, you and Janine have some thoughts about that. I mean, CFR, I know, has done some work on that. Janine, I'll let you go first.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is a global trend in a way, and I think that in some ways we're our own worst problem, and that is that we have a sense of what's considered normal, and our institutions and our legal systems are all based on what we consider normal. We've defined war in one way, we've defined crime in another way, and especially in the South China Sea, East China Sea with China, you see them actively operating in that zone there. So they can send things that don't look like warships out to defend this big, you know, oil rig, so that if there's a response by us or a partner or ally in the region that looks military, the escalation is on, not on them, right? And they don't do this accidentally. It's very crafty, operating in the gaps and seams of our norms, if you will. And I think Vladimir Putin is really crafty doing the same thing. Again, we have the sense of, well, you know, that wouldn't be smart for him to do this or for him to do that. It wouldn't be smart for him to continue to provoke or put little green men in Estonia. And I agree, it wouldn't be smart. That doesn't mean he won't do it, right? And so I think that when we think about what is the response, we have to think about what is it, not just militarily, but economically and politically. And we always, in fact, we've been talking about this today, we in the United States, especially in Washington, D.C., are constantly talking about things like the interagency and all elements of national power and whole of government. Well, Vladimir Putin has demonstrated how to do this. And we should probably go to school on that. Whereas we have one economic response, we have a political response, we have a military response, and they're not connected. We think that if we have an economic response that it's not as provocative as a military response. Well, you know, maybe that's not so true. It's not. We have to watch. I mean, I think that Vladimir Putin would consider some of the sanctions that are starting to turn up the heat on him as pretty provocative. And since he's a full-spectrum guy, do you think he's just going to respond economically, or what else is he going to do? And I think there are a lot of unknowns here in terms of what hybrid warfare means. And I think we throw the term around a lot, but we have not really lifted the hood and figured out how this machine works.
I won't belabor the consensus here because I agree, and I think our report, this is one of the big takeaways to just say, don't think that you're just going back to conventional war. What is even conventional war? The state adversaries and non-state adversaries alike employ the widest suite of tactics, and it's incumbent upon the military as well as the entire government to develop effective means. And I think the Russian case simply underlines this, as it's almost certain that Putin would not court tripping in Article 5. He will do everything else to achieve his goals and thus hamstring any U.S. or NATO response. So I think it's just a call for the U.S. To begin looking at warfare in a new way.
Linda, thanks. And so just a follow-up question for Michael. So we've kind of talked about Russia, Ukraine. We've talked a little bit about the Asia-Pacific and kind of China as it looks at territorial issues. You briefly touched on Central Africa. Would you kind of expand a little bit about your thoughts about the Central Africa scenario?
Well, Nigeria, of course, is the largest population in Africa by far. It's also now the largest economy. And so the Africa scenario that I'm trying to think through is, how could we ever imagine getting involved in something pretty messy there? And obviously, we all can use our imaginations and speculate. But obviously, with Boko Haram being a major threat to much of the north and center of the country, and potentially being able to turn itself from a terrorist group into a terrorist/insurgency group, you have the potential for that to become a bigger mess. I think one thing we have to, as students of war, and I like the line of questioning that you're pursuing now, General, because does get us thinking about these complex operations and complex entities we might have to cope with. As students of war, we can't really accept, on the simple terms that he used it, the term terrorist to describe ISIS that the President Obama used in his speech to the nation on September 10th. It's more complicated than that. I don't blame him for using that phrase in some sense at a political level, but unfortunately ISIS is embedded within 8 or 10 million Sunni Arabs, many of whom are willing to tolerate and condone it. So it may not be a proper insurgency, but it's something more than a terrorist organization. To the extent Boko Haram can do that in Nigeria further and wind up really largely embedded within a population of tens of millions in that case, then I think you have the question of how do we help the Nigerian state improve its ability to deal with that threat. And there are a million directions it could go, but just focused on the sheer size of the country, which is going to be 200 million pretty soon, I think you're going to have to think about various kinds of, let's say, some of the security force assistance team constructs that you all perfected in Iraq and Afghanistan. I'm not suggesting we send 10 divisions to Nigeria to fight Boko Haram and the populations within which it's embedded, but I think helping the Nigerian state as part of a broader political strategy deal with that kind of a threat is the biggest single thing one could point to. And when you see the risks of parts of Africa being largely ungoverned, being in a state of extreme failure, not only in terms of the potential growth of a group like Boko Haram and related kinds of insurgencies that it can embed within, but also Ebola and other things, you can't really view the stability of Nigeria as irrelevant to American national security. So this is a good case where we've got to avoid the either or. Either we do full-scale stabilization or we do nothing. A failing Nigeria, if we ever got to that point, would require us to think creatively about a middle ground, which I'm still trying to work through myself. But again, I think some of the pieces that would be relevant would be things like our security force assistance teams.
Thanks. Janine?
I think that Mike brings up something that I find very important, and that is rethinking the way in which we conceptualize and do military plans. And I think that up until even very recently, we still have a very short-term sensibility about plans. And even the plans and the options that are presented are often like, well, we can do this. You know, what can you bomb to fix this? What can you get done, you know, in a 1 year or a 2 year or a 3 year? Because we have this hangover from the Vietnam era that says that we have to get it done quickly or the American people will pull the rug out. Well, actually, how many years have we been in Afghanistan? Right? And this is why I think that this leads us, unfortunately, and it's not just on the military side, it's on the civilian side as well, to a cheap coat of paint scenario, right? And you've all probably done this. You go to paint your living room and you buy a can of paint, you buy the cheap stuff and it's peely and yucky after one day and you have to buy another can and then you got to go get another one. And then before you realize you should have gone and bought the Benjamin Moore the first time and done it right the first time, now you're out of money. So now you're out of goodwill from the American people, because the American people aren't so much impatient as they are intolerant, and that is they hate losing, okay? And so if it looks like you don't know what you're doing, and we don't know what we're doing, if we look like we don't know what we're doing, that's when the American people start asking questions. And so what I'm thinking when it comes to situations like what Mike's talking about, the instinct is to present options that are going to be quick, get in, get out, come home, make it clean, or big, you know, get in big and come home. We need to be a lot more creative than that, because I think that the nature of conflict is more complex than that. If that's one thing we've been talking about the last hour and a half, is that the nature of conflict is more complex. It's going to require multi-element solutions. And as you're hearing with the ISIL threat, we know there is no short-term, no military-only, and no American-only solution to this problem. So we can't throw down a cheap coat of paint on this. And we have to be honest with ourselves, and we have to really genuinely think through what that means when it comes to military planning and presenting options for the complex conflicts we're going to find ourselves in the next 20 to 50 years.
So your timing is perfect, because I just got handed a question that really touches on this. So why don't we do a better job of developing better integrated plans that bring to fore the elements of national power? I mean, you've written about this, you've talked about the friction, but you've also talked about in your writings about the lack of completeness, and you highlighted just here. So I mean, it kind of gets into how the Army supports the combatant commanders, et cetera, et cetera. But what are your thoughts?
I mean, I think there's a couple reasons for that. I think one reason is because we don't actually know how to do it on any side, right? Does anybody here have an answer to the ISIL problem right now that isn't going to turn the problem into an American problem? We don't necessarily know how to do it, the concepts that are required, and that takes a lot more thinking and conceptualizing about the nature of conflict. But in other cases where we do have a little bit more of an idea, we don't always agree, okay? And I think that, you have people on all sides of the Pentagon and in the combatant commands and in your own staffs who disagree about the right approach to get something done and how to integrate economic tools and military tools. And then there's the third reason is that the system doesn't work like it's laid out in your doctrine handbooks, okay? There is no, first of all, the interagency is not a noun, so it doesn't really exist. So there is no actual one place where everybody can go to do this interagency coordination. In a crisis, it often happens in the White House, and it comes together in the best case scenarios, and I've seen it happen in some cases very, very well, where you get the right people in the room and they can conceptualize what needs to be done and they're able to agree and they convince the president and its civilian and military, State Department, the Pentagon, Joint Chiefs of Staff, OSD, combatant commanders. But a lot of time, most of the time, it doesn't happen that way. And so Linda, actually, I think in her work, has done a lot on how to fix those processes. And I think that that's incredibly important. But when we get the processes fixed, if we come to the table and we still don't understand the nature of war, we still don't understand the nature of conflict and how human it is and what needs to happen, and we don't agree with it across the civil-military divide, then we're going to be in trouble. And the last thing I'll say about that is that our educational systems are different. There are lots of nodes in the system of the PME that I could touch, I could lecture at, I can adjust your professional development and teach you different ways to think about conflict. But on the civilian side, it's a lot of different civilian schools. And as someone who's taught at the graduate level in universities, it's stovepiped even more than you would imagine. And so you get people on the civilian side who are very smart on economics. Most schools don't teach warfare anymore or security studies, and I think that that's a problem. I think that we need more schools that do that, like the Woodrow Wilson School or SAIS or MIT. It's astounding when you get a group of people together and you have to sort of a group of policymakers and military generals and admirals in a room, and you find yourself backtracking to explain the basics of deterrence theory. So what are we teaching in our schools? So I think there's multiple elements from education all the way to process that leads to this problem.
So some people describe it as a clash of cultures. I really describe it as we're raised in different systems that then we come together at interesting mm-hmm. intersection points, and we don't do much to necessarily educate and prepare those leaders that get thrown into that crucible. So, Lynn, I know you've written a bunch about this too in your paper.
Yes, well, I just will cite some of the points which you've already referenced, but I think there is no systematic education of civilian policymakers, and that is a critical gap. And I know there was some effort made, I think, when Ike Skelton was still in Congress to try to get some of that started, but I think there is an absolute requirement. We, in our study, looked at some of the ideas from the Eisenhower era and the policy board. There also was, in earlier years, a kind of approach to using the NSC as the neutral broker, the arbiter. And so there are a lot of things about process that I think should be looked at. I'd also like to just quickly say, I think there is a tendency to use security cooperation as kind of a repetitive activity without policy goals established to achieve those ends. So I think we need to probably look at a number of these things that we're doing around the world at smaller scale in a quiet way to give more effectiveness to the prevent and shape, to use the Army prevent, shape, and win spectrum to try to get after that. And I also think the small Small footprint models do exist. A lot of people have dismissed the Colombian Philippine cases as easy cases with a small threat and a duly constituted government. But those actually, and I know Colombia quite intimately, had severe problems, and a small footprint long-term approach did manage to achieve quite a lot. I think in the case, though, of Iraq and Syria, you've just got the worst, hardest possible problem because, well, we all know the problems, but in essence, your proxy forces are deeply problematic, and only a long-term approach coupled with a political strategy is going to make it work. But I do think actually it can work, and I think there has to be a commitment to a long-term approach in that important part of the world.
If you and Janine would comment, based on all your experience looking kind of at the interagency and the kind of what we've done in the past, is there one or two things that you two would suggest to try to change this process to bring it into more whole of government?
Well, it depends on who you're, on which Janine you're asking, and that is, you know, I mean, you can only control what you can control at the level that you're operating at, right? I mean, so if, you know, the person who runs the National Security Council can arrange it in such a way that it's more of a of an engine of coordination, and any president can organize that staff and that structure in however they want, and that is the inherent flaw by design of that structure, right? Because one president may see that as their personal advisory staff, and another president may see it as something that is very much used as a coordinating body, which is what you're taught in your doctrine. So it could go either way. So if you're asking Janine, the president of the United States, I would probably do it in a coordinating way or in a way that could do both. The other thing is that the National Security Council and the National Security, the staff in the White House is small. And so, and it's, I don't see it, it's not gonna get bigger anytime soon. That would require like Congress. And that would mean that Congress was empowering the White House. So we'll leave that one. But what I think, what I often give people advice at the, you know, from the general level down, you know, you're not gonna change the White House's structure, but you can coordinate at your level. Stop waiting for the boss man or some magic interagency person to call the party. You know, you call it yourself, and you start the buzz. And we've done this before in certain scenarios where we'll get, reach out and find your counterpart at the State Department or the USAID or Treasury, and you start that conversation and you start thinking about those things at your level. And then your boss will eventually ask you for that information. And then you're basically, you're like an insurgency on the bureaucracy. You're basically then moving those same ideas up all those agency channels. You're using the systems that exist independently after having coordinated. And I think that in an imperfect system, it's a pretty effective way to get stuff done. It's a very effective way in Washington to get those, to get, once the big leaders are sitting at the table when the crisis occurs, they will have been fed and staffed by the people that have been thinking it through at your level. And I think that that's really important, and it should not be discounted. So don't wait, just start doing it.
I would like to just say two quick things. We picked up a lot of very scary anecdotal data about how many IPCs, DCs, and PCs occur to reach one particular decision that may actually be a very tactical decision. So I know we've made a lot of comments about improving process and education, but obviously how you use your process is what matters. And I'd like to reference, actually Frank Hoffman was the one that brought it up in a conversation, but I spent a lot of time over in Iraq, and HR, General McMaster's Joint Strategic Assessment Team exercise was one of the most I think effective processes of getting multiple stakeholders together and saying, do we understand the problem? And what do we need to change about how we're going about it? And I think that, to me, represents a model that could be very easily raised up to the strategic level, asking the right questions, getting the right people around the table, and then coming up with some profound and frank answers. So it's not rocket science, but why isn't it happening in the Beltway? I don't know.
Two thoughts. The NSC staff is the president's. He organizes it. the way he sees fit to support his decision-making style. Presidents are different. So it's his staff. It's no different than any commander, you know, and when commanders change, new commander comes in, the personalities change a bit, the staff adjusts a bit to the commander's decision-making style. That is a fact that I watched the two administrations. Secondly, I would say that as a senior director over there, the words I always wanted to hear was, we don't need to have this meeting because state and defense got together and solved the problem. I can't tell you that it happened very often, but that was music, absolute music to my ears. I'm going to go back to the AUSA a little bit for you, General Perkins. And here's my question for you, and it came from a great audience member who said, you know, hearing the Chief of Staff of the Army talking about the AOC in terms of it being, you know, irrespective of the budget, is not time your most limited resource? And well, he specifically talked about time to innovate, time to market, time to develop the right relationships, time to deploy it. So I know you're taking the long term, but how much time do you have as you bring this thing together and then you get it out there so that the force understands it and it becomes the organizing construct?
Yeah, so, I mean, time is always the one resource that is the most precious. For one thing, there's no OCO spending on time. You can't say, well, I need more time this year, and so put it in the OCO budget, or, well, we didn't get the time we needed this year, but next year there's more time. What we are trying to do, it kind of gets back to, it's time with regards to sequencing the events properly. I told folks is when I showed up in TRADOC, people run around and said, Dave, you know, the answer is this. If just everyone had one of these little white boxes and we had more of them, it'd be great. They fit in your pocket. You know, they're impervious to rain, et cetera, like that. And they kept coming to me with what I call simple answers. So they come to me with simple answers. I said, you know, I'm not really interested in simple answers. I need to ask big questions. So right now I'm in the job of asking big questions because you've got to do that first. So I found it's not the problem we have isn't always a time issue. It's what sequentially, how are we using our time and how are we going about it? Because if I just run around chasing shiny objects, but I don't have, that's why we're focusing on the concept right, the problem is I can't array them in time and space and I'm not making good use of them. And so you have to figure out what do you have to do first and then what follows on to that. And in many ways, it gets back to this previous question of the interagency piece or whatever that, you know, it's a large bureaucracy. We all live and thrive in large bureaucracies. And, you know, when I came to TRADOC in a previous job, you know, it's like this Byzantine Empire. And they're like, well, sir, there's this General Officer Steering Committee, and then there's this VTC, and then there's this and that. And what we really need to do, we need to realign all this, and you need to run this VTC, and you need to run this meeting, et cetera. I said, you know what? I'm not really interested in owning the process. I said, what we want to do is own the ideas. Because if we own the ideas, then the ideas can drive the process. And so that kind of gets back to the time piece. You can save a lot of time if you start with good ideas. Otherwise, if you don't have good ideas, you just spend all your time chasing shiny objects. And I'm always telling my folks, do not confuse doing a lot with getting a lot done. We all do a lot, and it takes a lot of time, but we don't necessarily get a lot done. Because we run out of time because we never ask the big questions first and we're chasing small answers and shiny objects. And so we're never going to be able to change the time aspect of it. So we're trying to figure out what are the big ideas and then what has to come next. And so how do we sequence it? And that's the Army operating concept, I think, has tried to put that discipline of thought into it. In other words, what's the environment? What is the future? Describe it. What does the Army have to do? What is a process to get after the capabilities we want, so it's the warfighting challenges, et cetera. Then align, at least within TRADOC and the Army, get your governance process right so that when you come up with the big questions, you have a way actually to answer them and they get good guidance and let it drive the process. And so we're trying to, because time is the one thing that we're never going to get more of, we're trying to make better use of it by having good ideas and a good process to answer those ideas.
Thanks. A follow-up question for you has to do with, you know, how you see the, you know, the National Guard and the Reserve component kind of dovetailing into this.
Yeah, so, I mean, Michael brought up a good point earlier that sometimes a shiny object is, well, let's just, you know, realign the cohorts and things like that. But again, I drive back to, well, okay, but what is the future like? Is it going to get more predictable or less predictable? More chaotic or more ordered? on and on and on. And then once you kind of ask those big questions, you say, so therefore, if the future is more like this, what kind of forces, and I think Michael was getting to it, do I need in the active component versus what do I need in the guard and the reserve versus, well, let's do what's equitable and everybody gets a third or something like that, or for maybe other various reasons. I think we need to take a look at, after I've sort of defined the problem, what capability is best suited for the guard to maintain a level of proficiency as well as an efficiency of resources. Same thing what happens in the active force. And that's not always how we've looked at it. We've made decisions for different kinds of reasons, and I think we need to review those reasons as hard as it may be.
Thanks.
So Michael,
just add one more quick point on this. When I think through some of the scenarios that are on my list and probably some of the scenarios on your list, as we look to the future, to make deterrence credible, we also have to ask how much of a time lag can we afford before there would be a credible response? Because if you think about the way in which modern democracies react, it's obviously difficult to gin up a nation for a big military operation. There's a lot of resistance to that. And if you need 2 to 3 years to be able to undo an aggression, it's a lot easier to learn to live with it. And frankly, maybe sometimes it would even be the right answer if you left yourself with no other choice. And therefore, I think it's important in dealing with a would-be tyrant, dictator, aggressor abroad to try to make the credibility of American response as high as possible. And I do think that that is increased to the extent that at least the first credible contingent of deployers would be in the active force or in some kind of a very, highly ready reserve component, which probably means not the BCTs, but more the niche capabilities or the support capabilities. So again, I don't want to open up the entire can of worms of how we think about these three organizations, but as I think through my scenarios, deterrence does depend to some extent on timeliness of response.
Yeah, actually, if I could build upon that,
please.
And so, and we bring these 2 points out in the armory operating concept, the principles of multiple dilemmas and multiple options for our policymakers. Because we're talking now at the strategic level, win at the strategic level, one of the ways you win is you present your enemy with multiple dilemmas. In other words, it can't just be a single dilemma that they're doing a cost-benefit analysis. Well, I can take that risk, I can mitigate it, et cetera. It's kind of like if you're playing chess. If you want to put somebody in checkmate, that means any avenue that they turn, you have a response to that. So there's multiple dilemmas, because what we're trying to do is raise the risk to them to so high, well beyond anything that we think is reasonable, that it is going to prevent their activity. It will prevent some sort of active adventurism that we don't want. But then the other thing has been alluded to here, and the time aspect is a major portion of this, is we, the Army, need to provide our policymakers multiple options. If if I talk to some of my friends who live on the other side of the river from the Pentagon, one of their criticisms is, well, the military does, they provide me ultimatums. They don't provide me options, it's ultimatums. Either you send this many of this kind of stuff, or we do nothing. Or I mobilize all this, or I do nothing. Then we have to say, I have many different options I can prevent you, and my many options are gonna prevent many different kinds of dilemma to the enemy. Because what the potential aggressors are trying to do is they're trying to, if they're going to, in their risk-benefit calculus, they're saying, you know what, if I can raise not only the military risk, but the political risk to the United States to such a level that they're unwilling to pull that political trigger, whatever it is, then maybe I can get away with what I'm trying to do. So we have to make sure that we have multiple options at a fairly low level of political risk for our policymakers, because what that is going to do is raise the strategic risk for those that we are looking to compel their activity. And see, that's the difference between developing a concept to win at the tactical operation level versus a concept to win at the strategic level. Because now you're trying to influence your enemy's decision risk-making criteria, which means you have to influence the U.S. policymakers' political risk analysis that they're going through.
So as we get ready to close, and I'll ask everyone to just make a final closing point or two, and then we'll finish with you, General Perkins. If I might, I would add one other comment to what you said. As military professionals, as defense professionals, you owe the president's team a range of choices, not a preferred COA. I mean, no commander wants a directed course of action. So why would you believe the President of the United States is going to accept a directed COA? Trust me, boss, it's all good. There's no risk. We've looked at everything, slapped the table. It's fine. It's not going to happen. And so you just have to keep that in mind as you move into these, what I call this political domain and civilian leadership domain. They're going to ask hard questions, and they have a right to, because they have to mobilize the American people and decide how to whether the COAs we offer achieve the end states, can help terminate the conflict on grounds deemed acceptable, and is a whole of government, whole of society solution that will get to the end state that we say we can deliver. So I'll go down this way, and we'll finish with General Perkins and give him the last word, certainly, for this AOC concept. And then when we're done, if everyone will just allow us to get off the stage to go do a presser, then we'd deeply appreciate it. Thanks. Linda.
Thank you. Again, it's really been a pleasure to be here with you this afternoon, and I would like to just echo, I think this is a very important idea, the multiple options approach, and it mirrors some discussion in our document about what we call a theory of success, as opposed to a theory of victory. And I think it's just a way of trying to frame objectives and end states in a more realistic way and recognize that a number of outcomes can be acceptable and in a constrained environment, that is, I think, a more sophisticated way to approach strategy. I also want to salute the Army operating concept for its emphasis on jointness, because I think as the largest service, the Army does, it not only provides a wide array of capabilities, but it is the natural thought leader and indeed leader for so many of these efforts. So I think it is very important that the service think in those terms. And finally, I didn't mention this, I don't know if it came out, but special operations has been named as a core competency in this document for the first time, and I think it's a very important recognition of what has happened over the last 13 years. Special operations forces have become an integral part of how the joint force operates, and I think the Army concept recognizing that paves the way to a lot of the innovations. And indeed, if you look at the central idea, the solution and the supporting ideas, there's a lot of good material there. And I think this is very important for the SOF community writ large, because our SOF is 50% of all of SOF, and in fact, the large majority of its so-called maneuver force. That's all I've got.
I'll just say two things. First, on the options piece, I could not agree more. Obviously, I've written about this. I lived it when I was in the Pentagon. Multiple options is what the civilian leadership wants, and I know how the planning process works. Some of that stuff shakes out at the lower levels, and then it doesn't make its way up. That's not good enough. Best military advice does not mean one fully fleshed out, tip-fit-oriented plan that you know exactly is going to vanquish your foe. It is creative advice that helps the president make complex decisions in a really nasty, complex world. And that is going to require heavy thinking, and it's going to require changes to the way the military does their planning and thinking about operations. And I think that this concept helps you kind of get started at that, with that sort of end state in mind. The other thing I would say, you know, I see a lot of Army people kind of walking around Washington with a sort of, you know, sad look on their face, like everybody wants to cut the Army, man, you know, we're losing in the budget deal, and wah, you know, and it reminds me of in the 90s, the Army had this the slogan, relevant and ready. Remember that? And I was in the Air Force at the time, and I thought, man, relevant and ready, you don't have to say that. I mean, of course you're relevant, you know, of course you're relevant. And of course, America needs an incredibly creative and intelligent and ready land force. And I think that people who think that complex human-oriented conflict on the land is a thing of the past are going to be proven wrong in the very near to mid to long-term future. It is the nature of human beings to have this kind of conflict, and it is incredibly important that the Army continues to keep that candle burning and thinking through how to solve those problems in a complex way.
I guess the only final thought I would add is that General Perkins used the idea of time a minute ago and talking about the constraints on time. If I take a different definition of time or different perspective on time, and just look at where the U.S. Army is today in 2014. Again, people in this room have been through a lot, but it's an incredibly good Army historically, and it's a moment in history when I hope we'll be able to look back and say this is a battle-seasoned, smart, sophisticated Army that has come off two big, huge missions, a lot of smaller important missions, and frankly, maybe, even though it's tired, and or at least it has a right to be, it is probably the best the U.S. Army has ever been intellectually. And so you're capturing some of that brilliance for future generations that I hope and pray will not have to learn it and not be able to learn it on the battlefield the same way you did, at least not to the same extent. Which means if we look back, this is a moment in Army history when the amount of institutional wisdom is remarkable. And, you know, someday I'm going to go and tell my grandkids that I got to be on a panel with General David Perkins and got to talk with H.R. McMaster under Ray Odierno, and I hope their students enough of military history to realize, and General Wolff on stage, the kind of brilliance that we have in our Army that has been earned the hard way. And so this is a moment to capture that wisdom before a lot of the people who developed it retire and go on to a much deserved retirement. But again, the moment in time that we are living right now means that the value of this document could really transcend any four-year cycle, and I hope it'll be looked back upon as something that captures an historically remarkable U.S. Army.
General Perkins, last word to you.
I'll finish up the same way I started. Yeah, what they said. What I want to make sure is, first of all, clarify what the document is not. It is not a sort of feel-good document, an easy war. We're just going to stop making bad decisions. We'll never do that again. Just press a few buttons, it'll be over, et cetera, like that. It is not that. It is meant to be a very serious document written by very serious people, as Michael said, that are very experienced, that have had a lot of skin in the game, have seen a lot of blood spill since 9/11, and are very serious about really capturing the essence of the nature of war, of the role of the United States in the world, what the Army does with regards to that. It is not a force structure document. It is not a budget building document. It informs those kind of things. It is hopefully not overly parochial. It is adequately parochial, but not overly parochial. And it really is meant to set the foundation for a very long period of not only introspection, but be able to influence those even outside the Army about how can we do better as a nation and make sure the Army is doing all that it can as we provide a capability that really continues to get better and better so, as we just said, we don't lose this great experience and insight, which quite honestly only comes from having done it yourself. If you have not actually been in war and suffered all the scar tissue learning, et cetera, like that, you can try to imagine what it's like. You can imagine bad decisions that are like, but actually going through that and living through all the challenges of interagency this and joint that and coalition that, it has a searing experience. It is very difficult to get reading a book by the fireplace. So we're trying to capture that at this moment in time and make sure that we are doing the right thing for the right reason. So I really appreciate all the fellow panel members up here, as well as those of you carved out a couple hours of your day to come listen to us talk about. So Terry, back to you, thanks.
So well, thank you everyone for your great questions. I'm guilty of liberal license. As I got them, I modified them a bit to pick up some key ideas. We appreciate your interest today and folks sticking around and allowing us to talk to you about this. And thanks General Perkins for and the TRADOC team for organizing this and getting us all pulled together for this, and to my fellow panel members, it's really great seeing you all again. And go read what these people are writing. It's really quite remarkable. Thanks a lot, everybody.
Thanks, sir.
Ground guide, all right. We'll follow you.
Hey, Michael, thanks. Really appreciate your intellectual engagement, not only in this, but everything we've done. I guess we go on this way, exit stage, right?
Did you want your stuff?
Yeah.